Hi all, my name is Mark Rossman and I'm a customer success manager at Monte Carlo, with the creator of the Data Observability Catalog. And I have the distinct privilege today to speak with Vinnie Gilchrist, the Senior Director of Engineering, Data and Analytics at Tenable. We'll be having a fireside chat about how his team built their modern enterprise data platform with reliability and scale in mind. How to build and scale a modern data platform is one of the buzziest topics in data today, and for good reason. By treating data as a first-class citizen and giving stakeholders the tools to self-serve and deploy data products, data platforms can help organizations accelerate data adoption and drive business value. But it's not easy. Data platforms can involve large organizational and technical shifts that must be carefully managed and communicated, like ensuring trust in the data itself. We all know that building and scaling data platforms are hard, but it becomes 10 times harder when you factor in the need to ensure data trust and reliability. After all, what's the point of building great dashboards and data-driven services if your stakeholders can't trust them? I have had the pleasure of working with Vinnie and the Tenable team, and I couldn't be more excited to deep dive into how they designed their platform for growth to support over 40,000 customers and petabytes of data. So today we're going to learn a little more about how Tenable have built their data platform and how they're using data observability to help ensure trust and reliability. Without further ado, let's get started. So hi, Vinnie. Would you mind introducing yourself and telling us a bit about your role at Tenable?
Sure. Hi, Mark. Thanks for inviting me to speak on this topic. It's definitely something we're very interested in. My role in Tenable is ultimately I'm responsible for data platform. So a little bit about Tenable, maybe. What's kind of important is Tenable is a B2B business. Our customers rely on us to basically manage their cyber exposure. So historically, that's been mostly been focused on server vulnerability management. It's now extended into covering a much wider attack surface with the evolution of cloud, IoT, OT. The attack surface has kind of increased really significantly. And Tenable has evolved with the space to really focus on providing a platform level solution, which is obviously underpinned by the data platform. So I'm responsible for the data platform in Tenable. That encompasses data science, it encompasses the ingestion of data into our platform, and then the further process and storage of that data, and providing the analytical capabilities on top so that our customers can get access to the data, and also that we can provide insights to them. So our customers, so there's the actual large customers that use our product. My customers in this scenario are basically internal applications built on top of our platform. So that's how the company has really evolved. So we're responsible for ingesting all the data. It could be from third-party data. It could be from our own sensors, and ultimately making it available in a consumable format for the applications to provide that data back to the customers and provide the insights, analytics that they want.
Perfect. Thanks, Vinnie. And can you tell us about the structure of the data organization at Tenable?
Yeah, sure. I would say pretty much every other organization, it's always a process. It's always in flux. How we're structured at the minute is there's one centralized data platform team in which I'm responsible. We then have a specific data processing and ingestion team that's responsible for ingesting all the data in. We have a lot of sensors and we ingest terabytes of data per day into the platform. So you have a team dedicated to ingesting the data. You then have a data engineering team that's responsible for pretty much making that data available. So providing analytical capabilities, providing basic reporting, and providing search capabilities is part of that as well. So there's a data science team, a data engineering team, a data processing team, and there's a search team. All with separate managers, separate sort of scrum teams.
Sure. And do you lead that team overall, Vinnie?
Yeah. All the relevant managers ultimately are part of the data platform organization, which I'm responsible for.
And you mentioned before about analytical data. Can you tell me how Tenable are leveraging that at the moment?
I can maybe start off by saying the general type of data we've access to, and then I can kind of explain how it kind of flows up into the system that we can provide self-analytical use cases. So the data, like Tenable, what they provide is a full stack solution for customers to manage the cyber exposure, their attack surface. where that mostly starts is a customer deploys a sensor in their environment. So the most popular one we have is Nessus. It's a it basically is an engine that can detect software vulnerabilities and misconfigurations in a customer's network on the assets that they have in that network. So that can pull back quite low-level data. We have the ability to kind of retrieve all the information we need to determine is there a software vulnerability on a device. So a device could be a laptop, it could be a server, it could be IoT, OT, etc. So the raw data we ingest into the platform is mostly along the lines of, okay, what type of device it is, and then what the findings are associated with that device. So a finding could be, okay, you have a vulnerability, or it could be there's a misconfiguration, or it could just be informational, just saying, okay, here's the operating system you have on that device. So the first responsibility we have from a data platform perspective is to just make sure customers can get basic reporting on that. Like customers' standard use case would be, okay, customer wants to know what critical software vulnerabilities have I got? So making sure that we have a platform that can answer them use cases. I wouldn't necessarily call them analytical use cases. They're basically just customer wants to know, okay, what's the state of the world now? And when we enter into like the analytical side of it, there is, I would say, basic analytical use cases where customers want to understand, okay, how are we doing? Like, has the number of vulnerabilities we've got, how's it trending? Has it changed day to day, week to week, month to month, etc.? Like your standard analytical use cases associated with that. And then I would say there's the more sophisticated, advanced side of it, where we provide risk metrics to our customers. So we provide exposure scores so they can see, okay, how much risk are they exposed to at this point in time, where we have got like machine learning algorithms that are ultimately them algorithms. And but our vision as a company is to be like a platform company, and data is our key product, like security data, and really allowing customers to interact with that data in the way that they want. Like that's starting off at basic reporting and then moving towards empowering customers to do ad hoc analytics, and then having the advanced analytical capabilities there as well, so that we can deliver machine learning type solutions to them is really, really key.
Got it. And in terms of the data stack that you provide, can you talk about like that end-to-end kind of solution that you have and that does ultimately get delivered to your customers?
I would say, once again, it's evolved quite a lot over the last period of time. So a major addition we made basically over the last year or two is to really add in like an advanced analytical engine or certainly a platform that can provide better analytics than we previously had. And so we did adopt Snowflake there. So the general stack, like in terms of what we use, so from a programming perspective, the teams use predominantly Kotlin, Python, and SQL, if you want to call it a programming language, is in there as well. We have a stream processing ingestion pipeline. So we, like these sensors are constantly firing data back at us. So we use, we've Kafka as a message bus, and we use Kafka Streams for basically the streaming component of it that ultimately gets the data streamed into our core platform. Then we use Snowflake pretty much for the storage of all that data, like the aggregation of all the data from all the various sensors we have. So that's where we basically consolidate all the data there. And that's pretty much where we provide like search capabilities, we provide analytics, all our risk type algorithms, any kind of benchmark, all that data runs generally in Snowflake, and then we can surface it up to customers directly from Snowflake. And we obviously, I know this, looking at your t-shirt there, so I forgot, we use Monte Carlo as well for data observability and piece of the stack, which that's really something we've introduced in the last year since we started partnering with Monte Carlo. So that's really something that we hadn't done a lot of in Tenable. So that's the general stack. Have I covered all the work, or is there anything else you'd like me to dive into?
No, I think that's fine. And we'll come on to like Monte Carlo and data observability in a minute. But just with like regards to your stack in general, what principles did you adhere to around that infrastructure and data ownership and governance, just to ensure that there's standards and quality of data running through that platform?
Sure. So the one thing I would say in general from a platform perspective, It's maybe a little different than what you're asking, but we have really like focused on scalability. Like as we've grown quite significant, we've made sure that any technologies we adopt, that they're scalable, they're managed where possible so that we don't have to reinvent something that's solved really well. Like that I would say is a general principle we have with pretty much everything we now do within Tenable. And from a data mm-hmm. quality perspective, like data governance, this is like quite new for us, and we've definitely matured quite a bit in terms of how we handle data. So the general principles there are like around like how we document data, like within the, like even down to how we develop the software to make sure there's proper documentation there to make sure that all the relevant teams can understand what we're trying to do. And we do make sure that we've a lot of controls around schema evolution, and we use Avro quite a lot in terms of how we store data, which makes it definitely limits the flexibility, but the positive side of that is you have better control over schema management, which has been one of the kind of pain points, I would say, in previous generations of the platform.
Okay. And how do you ensure that your teams adhere to those standards as well? Is there anything on the people side that you can talk about to ensure that everyone's kind of singing from the same hymn sheet?
Like because we now have a centralized data team, I think like there was definitely like training we would have embarked on, and ultimately, I think you probably have this in a lot of companies, but you could have, I would say in the past, had maybe situations where maybe one service was making changes that was impacting a service forward or downstream, and that was causing like incidents and scenarios such as that. I think that we put a lot of process around how we make any kind of changes. So there is, like from the people perspective, like just more awareness there, but also like formal processes from a development perspective around schema management is something that we've really invested in quite heavily to put guardrails to prohibit it. Or the platform, we handle that like with code essentially to make sure to minimize the dangers of an issue.
Sure. And in terms of like the data observability and the reliability piece, what encouraged you initially to start investing in data observability? Like, how did you first hear about it? Was it something that you actively seeked out to do? Interesting to hear your story behind that.
Yeah, like really, we've had over the period of time I've been in Tenable, which is almost 6 years at this stage. So we're all moving on to our second generation platform. I played a big part in building the first one and a really key part in tearing it down. Our data, and it's the same with most companies, like data is really key, and the quality of that data is everything. Like people don't, if you lose that trust, it's really, it can be quite difficult to build it back up internally and externally. The products that we provide are all around built around the accuracy of our data. Tenable's history and why they've been so successful is because we have the most coverage in terms of being able to identify vulnerabilities. So we've got the ability to do this really accurately. We then need to make sure that the integrity of that signal is not lost in the platform. So it's really core. Our customers totally rely on us. We're a key part of a customer's ecosystem. And they use our platform, for reporting analytics, but they also use it as a part of a wider problem that they're trying to solve in some cases by exporting data out. So data quality, really key. And there was definitely some learnings we had, I would say, in the early days of the previous platform where we did run into data quality issues. And that basically manifested itself in terms of maybe data being stale, or we would see some fundamental changes in the distribution of some of our metrics that we were providing. And that would result in CS tickets, like incidents, and in some cases, a breakdown in trust, which we had to rebuild. So our approach at that point in time was pretty much in-house. Like we'd go, like find a problem, we were basically building up like a smaller version of the data observability tools that are out there, like Monte Carlo. And when I first came across Monte Carlo and heard about what they were doing and saw the product, it really resonated with me quite a lot. And I think one of the principles I called out earlier is pretty much along the lines of, look, if someone else is doing this, if you've someone that's committed to it, that does it really well, let's use them rather than us buying our own in-house solution, which we were doing in our own way. Like, we're building up a battery of tests. Then we'd miss one and we'd go, we add one in again and it would continue. And we were just building up a monolith of testing code and and challenges around that. So that's really how we got to where we were. Like, so summing up, we were seeing some data quality issues, trying to put it in-house, running into just challenges around doing that. And it's also not our core value. Like, it's not what our mission is. Like, it's part of it. Like, it's something that basically is not going to differentiate us. It's just table stakes. So when there's a company that does it, like Monte Carlo, yeah, that basically became adoption we went for.
Okay. And so how does data observability now fit into your overall data strategy? And I guess, was it there kind of, pre Monte Carlo days? And if so, has it, how has it evolved since getting our products there?
Yeah. Data quality has always been really key. I think what I mentioned earlier was just challenging to do it, a never ending battle. And it was taking up quite a bit of our time. So it was something we were definitely focused on. What I would say is Monte Carlo and the evolution of the data observability space has kind of helped. Like, I think it's around the definition of contracts between the producers, data consumers. And that's something that where we've become more mature. Like, it's still a work in progress, but defining what the expectations are with only the people that use our product, which is the data, is really key. So internally, we're starting to formalize that now. And Monte Carlo are helping us to do that, whereas previously that would have been maybe difficult to get it in place, to get the reporting and have everything set up, whereas Monte Carlo is basically an enabler of us to get to that more mature place.
And do you have any metrics to measure that as well, whether it's whether it's the amount of data downtime incidents going down, for example, or getting quicker to fix those issues as well?
Yep. They're the kind of metrics we're looking to introduce. Our measure of success at this stage is basically the number of incidents we avoid, the reduction in CS tickets that we see, and we are looking to, I would say, formalize, what you call the data downtime. And that's something that we're looking to introduce that this year to get that properly in place and define the contracts and use that as a measure to basically make sure the teams are responding to it.
And in terms of the platform itself, what encouraged you first to partner with Monte Carlo?
Yeah, I think the message, I think Monte Carlo done a really good job of communicating the problems. I think how the problem that Monte Carlo was trying to solve really, it really resonated with me. I think the work that they've done to make everyone aware of data observability, the content was definitely very useful. The company always found really easy to work with, really responsive to any kind of challenges. And I think the maturity of Monte Carlo was ahead of maybe some of the other companies we looked at that point in time. They were the main kind of reasons at Monte Carlo.
And what are you finding most valuable about the platform that's helping you with data observability? Or any particular features or monitors that have proven very useful to you?
Because of our architecture, we basically have, I don't know, maybe 10, 12 different accounts, essentially. We call them sites internally. So really the ability to get monitors out there as code was really helpful. So to have that kind of functionality available, that was definitely important. The value, me personally from Monte Carlo, is really easy to get a monitor set up. like I was able to get one set up with the support of the team, like within like a couple of hours, like for some specific use case I was interested in. Just really easy, like even just getting a custom SQL monitor in place was really good. But then I guess getting the benefit of the recommended monitors, the like via the ML trend component of the product, is really nice that you get so many of them for free that mm-hmm. maybe taught to get in place. Like I think like that's definitely a set of mine, but really just easy use, like that it's okay, I want to get something done. It's not a big task to basically set up a new monitor, and then you immediately can get it hooked up into Slack and then start tracking alerts on it. But yeah, just generally easy use, getting set up really quickly. It's a pretty much a frictionless setup, which is really helpful.
Good stuff. And just going back to like the, I guess, the data observability concept and the idea of having good quality data in the business, how aware are people internally of that, of you know, how much that data has to be of a certain quality? Is that something, would you say, at the top of people's minds in their day-to-day work?
Absolutely, yes. Like, completely fundamental to everything. Every person, from the people who are selling our product to the customers, to any time I speak to a customer, to like an exec, they will focus on the data quality. If you don't have the data quality, if you don't have trust in that data, you're in a bad place, because everything we're doing is built on top of that data. Like, customers need to know accurately, okay, what vulnerability are they going to fix? And they need to know within an expected time frame. So having surety around that, like the quality of data that's going to be delivered on time as expected, is really key. And all the advanced analytics, like from a data science perspective, like we obviously need to make sure that that data is correct for any of the algorithms we build. And we also ingest a lot of third-party data as well, which brings an additional layer on predictability in, like something can happen there that can impact some of our algorithms. And we found Monte Carlo really effective at being able to identify them type of scenarios quicker than we would have been able to do.
Perfect. Moving forward, these days, I think no one has the patience really for spending a couple of years even to start building a data platform. How did you sequence the work to ensure that you could deliver value sooner?
Yeah, that's a good question. So really, I would say one of the key things we had is it wasn't like seen as a luxury that we need to basically build a next generation data platform. Everyone was aware that this is something we needed to do. We decided basically, okay, here are some specific use cases that we kind of target initially. So that we don't go build this kind of new data platform in a vacuum and then people start adopting it. It was kind of as components of the platform became available, we were actually delivering value pretty quickly. So we launched new applications on top of our new platform last year, which is probably maybe about 6 to 9 months into the project at that stage. We were actually able to launch an application to customers at that stage. Wow. And the platform, like developing the platform, is going to be basically a never-ending story. But really making sure we had specific use cases identified and that we weren't basically overshooting. Like we were really targeting on specific use cases and then evolving from there rather than trying to get everything perfectly right straight out the gate.
Okay. And any big learnings from that as well? Anything key that you might have learned from that, or that you might have gone back and do slightly differently?
Yeah, there's definitely a lot of learnings. I'm just trying to pick the ones that are maybe relevant.
Sure, really.
The sooner it's the standard with pretty much any project you take on. Like the sooner you get something out there that you can actually test. And I would say like getting requirements as well, like spending maybe a bit longer, I guess, looking at all the potential use cases at the start and like trying to get them requirements in place. I think like in some cases we could have maybe prioritized some things a bit more effectively if we had to, maybe take account of some of the use cases. So one of the kind of first challenges we ran into was around maybe the responsiveness, because we were going to power like applications directly from our data platform. So really, we had to do a lot of fine tuning to get the performance we needed at that interface between, say, the application and our data platform. Whereas, yeah, like I think if we had to maybe focus on that from the start, we could have been more efficient there. Other general learnings is like just standard stuff, bringing everyone along. We're building a data platform for the whole company. I think like making sure every potential stakeholder is involved and included is always key. And I think like in some cases, we maybe forgot or didn't communicate it out to every stakeholder. And they were kind of still bought into the previous platform.
Sure. And when it came from the transition from that previous platform to the new platform, did you do that in, you know, did you sunset one and then just like start the other one, or did you kind of have a migration kind of plan to do that?
Yeah, we needed a migration plan because ultimately for applications, customers to switch over, it's not trivial. So we pretty much had a period where both are running side by side for basically 3 to 6 months. So we would make sure that we didn't break anything before we fully switched everyone over.
Cool. And what are the top three takeaways you'd share with a data leader who is beginning to who's beginning a similar journey to what you've just been on in terms of that migration to a more modern enterprise data stack?
Business alignment, buy-in from like a really good exec sponsor, really critical. In our case, I would say we had at least two execs, and the CPO and the CTO were really heavily bought in, and they were able to give us cover because it's an all project. Like that alignment, and basically bringing everyone along internally, because even the people, people are working directly with customers, so that they're able to speak to what we're doing at that period of time, because ultimately you're building a new platform for a reason, and it's generally because maybe some of the use cases customers have can't be satisfied with the existing one, or maybe there's challenges there. But yeah, exec sponsors. I think like another good one is kind of what we touched on earlier, having a clear business outcome that can be delivered early is really, really key. I think a huge amount of these longer term projects fail because they just go on too long and people get tired of it, the kind of commitment, and never really gets the value. Having it as early as you can deliverable that will deliver business customer value is really key, and it'll also help you kind of focus on what you absolutely need to do rather than things you would like to do or think you might need to do. But having that clear use case defined up front, really critical. And then the other one, like I mentioned it before, like finding the balance between buying and building is really key. And we've seen that with Monte Carlo. We could have built something that maybe done kind of a similar job for a little while, but being able to basically a problem that someone else has solved for us, we shouldn't invest engineers' time, like opportunity cost, and just not being able to do it to the same level that a committed company is able to do is definitely something like a fundamental principle I've got. Maybe I'm biased or being born, but I think like if someone else does it really well, if you can make the financial side of it work, then definitely go with that.
Sure.
Strong recommendation I have, and like that's definitely what we're doing in terms of how we're building a platform. We're trying to integrate really mature components together.
Definitely hear you in that financial side, and also like I like the idea of ensuring that you've got that stakeholder buy-in too, as well as that business case that's clear at the beginning, that's kind of the golden thread that goes all the way through to having that successful implementation. So it looks like we're up on time. Thanks a lot, Vinny. Really appreciate you taking the time to speak with me today. Thanks a lot for ThoughtSpot as well, and for everyone who's joined the session today. And if you want to learn more about data observability, please visit montecarlodata.com.